So earlier we have seen the concept of total temperatures or total properties, which are respect to the pressure and temperatures, the stagnation and properties. So now we will be using those properties to derive the work done and the pressure ratio expression. So these are the, this is the pressure ratio P02 by P01. That is the pressure ratio in the impeller blade, and that is the same pressure ratio in the considering the fluid machine, because in the diffuser, the total temperature or total properties by whole are not going to change. And using the adiabatic relation or the isoentropic relation, we can write it in terms of temperature using the exponent gamma upon gamma minus 1. So gamma is defined as the Cp upon Cv. This is because of isoentropic process. And because here the temperature is going to be isoentropic temperature, but there could be an actual temperature which is not exactly following the isoentropic process, then we'll be using isoentropic process efficiency expression to get the actual temperature from there, which is T03. So the compressor isoentropic efficiency is defined using this relation. And we have two expressions for work done. One which is relating Cp delta T, and one which is using this velocity triangle. So we can manipulate these two relations, which is one of the work and another of the efficiency, and get T03 by T01 expression from there. And we can get a relation between T03 by T01 expression and the efficiency. So we can use the efficiency over here. Some manipulations will give this relation, where the V actual is being replaced from this expression to get the final expression for T03 by T01. So we know that the actual temperature rise, which is T03 by T01, is larger. So this is a larger gain than the isoentropic temperature gain, while the pressure ratios are same. So this is because of frictional temperature rise. So the isoentropic compression efficiency can be written in terms of ratios of work, ratios of enthalpy, or ratios of temperature. We can do this because the work is Cp delta T, and we can do this manipulation because the Cp is assumed to be remaining constant. So we earlier had the expression of pressure and temperature using an isoentropic relation. And over here, now we are using this efficiency expression to replace T03 by T03S, that is isoentropic temperature, to actual temperature, that is T03. So over here, the P03 by P01, that is the pressure ratio, is a function of the isoentropic compressor efficiency, the gamma, and the temperatures, that is the total temperatures. Now coming to another concept of Mach number. So Mach number is defined as ratio of the velocity of that fluid to the velocity of air in that medium. So the velocity of air is given by square root of gamma RT. The temperature is dependent on the condition which we are evaluating the Mach number for, and the velocity, while gamma and R will be constant. So we know that V3 and V1 are equal and they are subsonic, while the Mach number, if it is less than 1, it is called as subsonic. That is, the velocity is less than the velocity of air in velocity of sound in air, while greater than 1 Mach number means it is supersonic and the velocity is greater than velocity of sound in air. So at entry and exit, we have subsonic flow. And if at any point in between the flow, that is between the entry and exit, if the flow becomes supersonic, then there will be loss of energy because of shock wave. There is a shock wave generation. And when we come back from supersonic, so if we are going from subsonic to supersonic, there is no energy loss ideally. But when we are coming from supersonic to subsonic, there is a loss of energy. So transition from supersonic to subsonic always results in loss of energy. So we want to avoid this situation. And that's all. Like, we can define to another velocity or Mach number also, which is relative to the relative velocity. So earlier we were using V, that is the absolute velocity in the numerator. This is the absolute Mach number, but relative Mach number is more realistic in this case, because the blades are also moving, blades are also rotating. So over here we will be using this relative Mach number, which is using the relative velocity in the numerator. And we don't want, we have seen that the supersonic flow will be resulting into a loss of energy. So we do not want supersonic flow. So we want to reduce the Mach number. The highest Mach number should be reduced. So that is because we have seen the result. There is loss of energy. So if incoming air is not subsonic, how to reduce the Mach number at the inlet? Or even if we want to reduce the Mach number overall, what are two different ways? One of the ways we can introduce a pre-whirl. So what does it mean? At the inlet velocity triangle, we have known that VW1 is zero. But externally, we can provide a VW1 component, non-zero VW1. So we are giving a whirl component to the velocity at inlet. And due to this, that is a change in whirl component. And this change will lead to the change of V1. So by giving VW1, we are reducing VR1. We are reducing VR1. And VR1 is reducing. That means the relative Mach number will reduce. And the negative point, which is because of the pressure valve, is if there is loss of energy because we have reduced the energy transfer. Sigma U2 VW2 is going to reduce because of non-zero VW1. And the pre-valve reduces the relative Mach number as well as the energy transfer. We have seen this. And the second way to reduce the Mach number is reduce the blade speed. So because of calculations involved in velocity triangle, if the blade speed is reducing, the velocity or the absolute velocity is also going to reduce. That's the concept. Okay, fine. We'll stop over here.